like last presentation on the introduction of the course on carbon dioxide to chemicals and fuels. Now what we are going to see today is the few simple things about this. For example, photoelectron reduction of CO2 is, for example, we have a semiconductor. The principle is given on the left hand side and the practice is given on the right hand side. The photons are giving rise to an electron and a hole from the in the conduction band and the valence band, and the electron in the conduction band reduces this. That is what is happening. That is what is shown here, CO2 to reduction products. But in practice, this may not happen directly. So what we do is we have an some kind of a sensitizer. Methyl violation is here, methyl violation plus. So it has an electron affinity, very high electron affinity. I hope you are able to see. So that electron transfer or electron acceptor will transfer the reduction of electron to the CO2 plus 2H plus to give rise to the formic acid. Now the main advantage of this process, this is what people are always claiming, an important energy input contribution from light might be expected, thus diminishing the electricity consumption. So what it means is, if you go in the photoelectro reduction mode, you are gaining some amount of electricity by the photons. So the photon, electrochemical potential of the electrons is now altered by the photons, and hence that potential is what is being used to subtract the energy that is required for the reduction of the reaction. Now you can say, I hope you have seen this, that this was an indium phosphide electrode. Now if I were to look at here, I hope you are able to see, in the case of cadmium telluride CO2, you see what is the shift in the potential if I go in the photoelectro mode. Now the sequence of the reactions are given here. CO2 is getting absorbed as CO2 adsorbed. CO2 adsorbed plus electron give rise to CO2 minus adsorbed, and CO2 minus adsorbed plus water plus electron gives rise to the formate and the OH radical. The identification of the species is done by the formate radical, formate ion is identified by infrared. Now here a variety of electrodes are given on which we are looking at the electro reduction and also photo reduction. So here the efficiencies are given. I hope you are able to see the very high efficiencies are observed in few key systems. For example, you take ruthenium, you have 102, you many other platinum also, because these are all very good electron acceptors. Just like we had a methyl valence, the same way these metals have ruthenium and platinum and palladium are very good electron acceptors. That is why photoelectro reduction of carbon dioxide, you are getting the formaldehyde, because carbon dioxide is not decomposed to give rise to carbon monoxide. But on some metals, on palladium you are getting carbon monoxide, and zinc you are getting carbon monoxide. So therefore it will give rise to subsequent synthesis gas reaction. So now all these products that is identified here is by the GC. Some cases it is in the limit of the reduction, and in some cases the reactions are, for example, here the dark reactions are given. Okay. So now study on photoelectro reduction of CO2, what is reported before 1995 or 2000? Here it is very clear on the bare cadmium telluride is this. The moment we put the ruthenium or platinum or nickel, I hope you see the onset potential is decreasing. Decreasing is not correct, it is getting shifted. The same thing is what is seen here, copper, nickel, cobalt. Okay, and you will see that in the presence of cobalt, it is the carbon dioxide is adsorbed on the electrode, but the electron transfers are facilitated by this addition of the metals. So this is what is here. Metal is catalyst deposited on p-type of cadmium telluride electrode. The electrolyte is some quaternary salt. So now if the results are also given here, just like the previous slide, here also it is given. cobalt to thallocyanin, you can see what is in efficiency, 104. So in nickel thallocyanin, 77%, manganese thallocyanin, 75%, vanadyl thallocyanin, 89%, iron thallocyanin, 92%. The products are all similar to what we had in the previous. Both of them are from the same paper only. So therefore, the results will be the same, more or less same, or same authors. So the products that has been identified here are both gaseous products and those dissolved in solution. Because mostly people ignore one of the phases, but here it is analyzed in both the phases. So now, the same photoelectron reduction on peak cadmium telluride. Now osmium ruthenium iron, you see what is happening. So how the catalyst is put is taking the carbonyl compound and put that. So the current densities are given here, the micromole of the CO is given, the rate of CO production is given, the products detected is given, the efficiency are given. Okay, current potential curves for trinuclear carbonyl catalyst adsorbed on P type of cadmium telluride electrodes. So instead of the metals, we are now looking at the carbonyls itself being as an electron acceptor. Now the message that is coming out here in this paper is iron carbonyl is the best among the three carbonyls studied. These three carbonyls are typical carbonyls. You can have other carbonyls as well, but these are the typical carbonyls. Study of the photoelectro reduction of CO2 cadmium telluride. Now the product analysis is what is shown here. I think we have to go to the next slide. Okay, so now the best is the result is obtained with the iron carbonyl. That is what is current potential curves from crown ethers. Okay, this is not a carbonyls but crown ethers. The data is carbonyls, but the figure is for crown ethers added to the electrolyte of the P-type cadmium telluride electrode in DMF tetraethyl ammonium phosphate. Okay, this is 5% solution, not S% solution. So now I hope you are able to see that essentially the message is, if you look at it, you have to use some kind of an electron acceptor. In this case, it is a methyl valogen, but in all the other cases, it is either the metal or the metal carbonyl or metal thallocyanin or metal carbonyl or metal crown ether complexes. So now here what we are doing is there is a shift. I hope you are seeing the onset potential is getting shifted to the left hand side or less negative value. Okay, so now this shift, the magnitude of this shift is plotted here against the metal oxygen bond energy. Now metal oxygen or whatever it is, carbon oxygen bond energy as a function of MO bond energy. So now you can see that we have a linear relationship in both the graphs. So therefore, catalytic shift is, suppose if I want to reduce carbon dioxide at a lower potential, now I know what is the metal I have to use. For example, I want to use, assume that I want to use palladium, then that shift will be only 20 millivolts. Whereas if I were to use tellurium or ruthenium, the shift will be around 100 millivolts. The same logic is holding good here. This is what we have already seen. That cobalt and vanadyl species are giving rise to about 160 to 170, whereas nickel, iron, manganese, copper are all giving rise to lower catalytic shift. The same thing is shown here, trinuclear carbonyl complexes on P-type cadmium telluride as a function of the metal carbon bond energy. This is what we saw in the figure. I hope you remember this. These three two figures which we have shown. So now if I were to look at it, see iron is giving rise to the maximum iron carbonyl or iron crown ether, then comes the ruthenium, then comes the osmium. This gives us a facility to take the predictive capacity of these tools. So now these are all the possible ways we are going to see each one of them separately in subsequent lectures. Now, in this case, what is it that we want to do is the question. First of all, we have only, these are all only when I have a sufficient amount of carbon dioxide with me in some storable form. But where will I store and how will I store is the next question. Okay, so therefore we have already seen this disposal of the captured carbon dioxide directly in oceanic waters or injection of captured carbon dioxide in subset geological formulations, caves and other things it is possible to store, but these are all only possibilities. So quickly looking at the sequestration, okay, assuming that we are going to put it in the plant, you are going to do in many ways, in ocean, in caves and other things. The problem is, the barrier is the high cost of capturing, processing and transporting this carbon dioxide into those places. Now, second thing is, when we say we are capturing in water, in ocean and also in caves, we do not understand what is the way the carbon dioxide is stored. Is it stored under pressure or is it stored under in water, whether it is stored under solvation, what is the thing? Incomplete understanding of the reservoir processes, underdeveloped monitoring and verification of technologies. We know that it is in the ocean, carbon dioxide can be absorbed, but we don't have any means of, because there will be gradients and other things, we do not have any means of monitoring what is the amount of the carbon dioxide is present at any point of the time, at any given point of the place of the ocean. So unclear emissions trading regulations. Now even if I put it into the water or in the caves, they can get out of it. So therefore that will cause enormous changes in the climates near about that. So potential conflicts of interest between sequestration and also natural gas recovery is there. Now the public perception of this is that technology is in its infancy and unproven. The technology is costly. Definitely we cannot take carbon dioxide and put it into ocean. Not enough is known about the long-term storage of CO2, whether even if I put it in a cave or in ocean, whether it will be there, how long it will be there, how soon we should make use of the carbon dioxide is not known. The capture and storage of CO2 are seen as being energy intensive. That itself is an energy intensive process, because we have to capture and store it. Okay, we have to dissolve it in aqueous medium in oceans. The option presents an enormous engineering and infrastructure challenge. It is not a long-term solution. These are all possibilities, but we cannot use it for capturing carbon dioxide and storing it. Barriers can only be overcome by research and design, and effective demonstration of the technology is required before we talk about the sequestration. We are not going to deal with this sequestration, but we must know this sequestration. That is why we are putting this. So now, we have already seen that in these two modes, in the caves and in the ocean, we can store carbon dioxide, but there are limitations. Now, in the perceptions, in all the storage reservoirs that we have taken so far, the two, they are not economical. So we should necessarily reduce the cost. Then we should also develop alternate storage reservoirs. For example, in a cylinder, if it is stored, we know what is the pressure and all those things. Utilization scores on these two challenges, but opportunities are limited. So we have to take these two factors in the sequestration process, but we are not having any means of exploiting under these two conditions. Now, utilization of carbon dioxide directly will play a major role in carbon dioxide sequestration, but utilization will play a minor role for long-term scale of sequestration, because as soon as the carbon dioxide is directly available, if I can utilize them, then it is a good way of sequestration. Now, if I were to long-term put it into the ocean or caves and then utilize it, it is not going to give me any major advantages. Now, utilization is what we have been looking at. Utilization is changing into other chemicals. So, it helps the economics also estimates the storage issues, how much I am storing, how much chemicals that I am producing. Why large scale use of CO2 such a challenge? Okay, the problem is the market size. When I capture the CO2, what is the extent of CO2 I can capture? Then how will I transport this carbon dioxide? How will I produce the products and keep them in lifetime? And the energy considerations for production of this chemicals. So transportation cost is there. Many production sources available. Okay, carbon dioxide can come from thermal plants or automobiles, wherever it is, we not worry. So but many production sources are there, but CO2 is expensive to transport well in small quantities. We cannot transport CO2 because the quantity is very high. Use of sources of opportunities, process byproducts is necessary. For example, giving an idea about what is happening. Okay, you in the US, 1997 capacity for liquid CO2 is 9.7 million metric tons. And there were, in those days itself, 93 plants were there. The largest plant was 900 metric tons per day, whereas the average plant of the 92 plants is of the order of 300 metric tons per day. So therefore, essentially what we are trying to do is we are just recapitulating what we have done. What we have done is, first of all, we wanted to activate the carbon dioxide, and the message that we got is the electronic structure of carbon dioxide is such that the highest occupied orbital, I hope you are able to see, is the lone pair electron on oxygen. Okay, these are all the oxygen combination orbitals, because there are two oxygens. This is the atomic levels of carbon, and here the molecular orbitals are given. So therefore, the highest occupied level is the lone pair electrons, the two lone pair electrons that are present on oxygen, and the next level also is a pi orbital. What we want is to activate this sigma 1 u orbital. If I can do that, then only we'll be able to activate carbon dioxide to make the chemicals. So the logic that we used is that carbon dioxide can be put with various quantities of hydrogen, one molecule, two molecule, three molecule, four molecule, like that. So the, I hope you are able to see this picture, we have already seen. So this is only a recapitulation of all. So when I put the hydrogen directly, I will get the formic acid. If I were to remove the water, I will get the carbon monoxide. Once I have carbon monoxide and hydrogen, I can put the synthesis gas. Okay, two molecules of hydrogen or three molecules of hydrogen will give me methanol. Two molecules of hydrogen will give me formaldehyde. If I were to take carbon dioxide and put three molecules, I can put methylene radical, which you can couple in the Fischer-Tropsch reaction to give us the hydrocarbons, or four molecules of hydrogen to give us the methane. And all these processes, if you look at it, if on the on paper appears to be adding hydrogen and eliminating water, that, but it is not that much of an easy job. So now, quickly looking at the electrochemical potentials of the reactions and electrochemical reactions and their corresponding potentials. Now, water, if I were to take water and decompose it to hydrogen and oxygen, the decomposition potential is 1.23 volts in volts, and the delta G0 is given here in kilocalories per mole, so 56.7. Carbon dioxide plus hydrogen giving rise to formic acid, I hope you are able to see. We are going to see all these values later on. Here there is some gaps, you will fill it up later when we are going to do electrochemical and photoelectrochemical reduction of CO2. Now you can see that CO2 plus hydrogen gives rise to formic acid is a very nearly zero free energy reaction. Therefore, this is one of the feasible process. Now CO2 plus water giving rise to formic acid and oxygen, the potential is greater than the hydrogen here. So this is a direct reaction. Aqueous medium, carbon dioxide giving rise to electrochemical reduction. The electrochemical reduction is not correct, electrochemical reaction 1.34, but the free energy change is more positive. CO2 plus hydrogen giving rise to CO plus H2O, it is also a zero, very near to the zero free energy change. So these are the possible electrochemical reactions. We are going to look at them say later on. Then the carbon dioxide can be dissociated to carbon monoxide and oxygen. This is also very similar to the voltages, but the free energy is very high. Okay, I hope you are able to see. CO2 plus excess hydrogen gives rise to methanol and water. It is still feasible, but the free energy is very near to zero. Therefore, it is a slow process. CO2 plus hydrogen giving rise to methanol plus 2 water, the free energy is considerably reduced. So now you would understood that in the CO2 reduction, that is what we were talking. In the CO2 reduction, I have to make sure that my hydrogen is put into the system in an efficient manner, either 3 molecules or 4 molecules. CO2 plus water directly giving to methanol, the potential is favorable, but the free energy is not favorable. The same way CO2 plus water giving rise to methane, potential is favorable, but the free energy is not favorable. What it means is, at this potential, the reaction will take place, but the extent of the reaction will be very small. That is what it means. Now, sector wise, I said the production of CO2 is many ways. I hope you remember this. Many production sources. Therefore, what are the production sources which can be exploited? Okay, land use and forestry produces 70% of the CO2. Industry produces about 19% of the CO2. Residential and commercial buildings produce 8%. Transportation is producing 13%, and power generation produces 26%. Waste and wastewater, okay, and sewage and other things produces 3%. So now you see, whenever we want to reduce CO2, I have to worry about which is the source I'm going to use. For example, that is why we are telling that thermal power plants are yet more important. Industrial effluent has to be done, and then land use. Then only we should worry about the transportation. So now, before transportation, I have major contributors of the CO2. These are all those things which we must keep in mind. Now, here I have summarized what all we have seen in the carbon dioxide reduction. Now, just a minute. சரிம்மா சொல்லுங்க. என்ன மாதிரி இருக்கு சர்க்குலர்னா? நீங்க பர்ச்சேஸ்லன்னு பேசுறீங்களா? நாளை கிளம்ப வந்து நான் சால்வ் பண்றேம்மா. இப்ப ஒரு லெக்சர் கொடுத்துட்டு இருக்கேன். So I hope you are able to see the picture. Here I have summarized all the reactions that are possible on the CO2 reduction. Okay, we may not do all the reactions, but it is necessary that we understand them. So we can couple. We can couple CO2 with a variety of chemicals, ammonia, phenol, cyclic ether, and variety of the methane, alcohol, all of them. So now I hope you are able to see variety of products are possible. So we are not going to look at the chemistry of these products, but we are going to look at the methodology of generating these products. Okay, so that is what we are going to attempt in the next 4 or 5 lectures that we will be doing. So the barriers for the progress is the magnitude of the environmental consequences. That is what we have already seen. The economic cost of these consequences, options available that could help avoid or diminish the damage to our environment and economy, the environmental and economic consequences for each of these options, an estimate of cost for developing the technology to implement these options, and a complete energy balance which accounts for energy demanding steps and their costs. So this is what is going to happen. These are the references that I have used in the last 5 presentations. The topics that is going to follow is the dry reforming of carbon dioxide. So what is it that we are going to do? That is what is going to be the next lecture. Okay. Now, dry reforming. Reforming is already known. Reforming is synthesis gas generation from the reforming of naphtha. You put water and any hydrocarbon, you will produce carbon monoxide and hydrogen. Whereas we are now taking carbon dioxide and want to prepare the synthesis gas. I hope you understand what is the logic here. This will be our next step, because we are going to change all our, up to now we were only talking about or gossiping about what are the possibilities. Now we are going to look at the science of the CO2. So CO2 reforming is called dry reforming, because there is no water in this. I hope you understand the term dry reforming. So therefore we have to understand what is this reaction. Reforming of CO2 means what is it that we are going to do, whether we are going to put water or whether we are going to put dry reforming, we are going to put some other hydrocarbon. So what is this reaction and why this reaction? Okay, because when we choose a reaction to produce a thing, we have to also look at the thermodynamics and the energetics of the process. So we have to look at this. So now if I were to, for example, we are going to do a dry reforming of methane, okay, put methane and carbon dioxide, I am going to produce more carbon monoxide and hydrogen or water, whichever one we are going to do. What are the consequence concurrent possible reactions? So therefore the moment I am going to produce carbon monoxide and water, it will give me the reverse water gas reaction. Water gas reaction, I hope you know. So water gas, reverse water gas reaction, it will give carbon monoxide plus water will give rise to CO2 plus hydrogen is water gas reaction. So that the reverse water gas reaction will take place. So the reverse water gas reactions will inhibit the dry reforming of carbon dioxide. So we have to understand this more clearly. Then the basic thermodynamics of the reaction. It is easy to write methane plus CO2 giving rise to CO plus H2 or 2CO plus H2, but that is not enough. We have to make sure that the thermodynamics of the reaction of not only this reaction, also all the competing reactions we should do. Now, what is the catalyst system that can be done is the next question we have to ask. Okay, it is very clear that these catalyst systems have to be some metallic catalyst. Metallic components, it can be cobalt, it can be nickel, it can be any other thing. Okay, we are going to see all the catalysts that have been tried. Okay, but these catalysts cannot be used as such, they have to be supported. So when we are supporting it, then the consequence of the support, okay, metal support interaction will be there, the spillover effects will be there, all those things will be complicating our reactions. So given the choice that we have a variety of catalysts that are available to us for the dry reforming of methane, what is the rationally that we will use for the selection of the catalyst? These are the five essential points that we'll be dealing with in the next few lectures. In addition to that, what is the current achievements or current developments in the dry reforming of carbon dioxide? There is yet another process that is possible. Reforming is aqueous reforming. Okay, water is the substrate, one of the, but dry reforming means without the water. Then there is yet another reforming process that is possible, which is called dry reforming. Okay, we will deal with all these things in the next coming lectures. So with this, the introduction is over, so we are not going to go back on our introduction. So we will simply look at the future of the whole thing.